Siddhesh. I work in Red Hat. I am a maintainer for the GNU C library. And for the next 30 minutes or so, I'm going to talk about a feature that we've been talking about a lot for the past 2 or 3 years, which is tunable support for the C library, which essentially means a better interface to tweak the C library behavior. So, I've listed two problems here as problems that we wanted to solve, but it's actually just one problem, and the second one is more of an enforcement thing. So the primary problem we're trying to solve is that there are a lot of magic constants inside the C library, like the size of cache that we use for thread stacks, or the cache size for arenas, or the default starting size for the malloc FM threshold and so on. So there are a lot of these magic constants that have been introduced probably in the 90s using realities or the state of the art of the 90s where we thought those magic constants were a great idea. And they've persisted since, and in a lot of cases we don't know why those constants were chosen during those times. So they may not be relevant anymore, but we don't know about that yet, right? And a lot of constants were probably even heuristic, where somebody tested a specific workload or a couple of workloads and said, that looks good, I'm going to use it at 128k or whatever that number is. The second problem that we wanted to solve was to maintain some kind of consistency in namespaces, if you're going to introduce tunables, we want to make sure that the naming convention for those tunables is standard, and we wanted to enforce that in our framework. So when I'm talking about tunables, at a very basic level, what I mean is environment variables that would be exposed exported in the environment of an application, which will change the behavior of the library. A very common example is your malloc mmap threshold, which will decide what would be the threshold of memory beyond which you use mmap to allocate your address space as opposed to allocating it on the heap. So these are the goals that we decided we're going to have for this tunables framework. The first one is we're going to first build the framework, and we're going to identify and manage these tunable variables within that framework, and we're going to make sure that it's as easy as possible to add new tunables to that framework. The first thing that we would do is port the current environment variables, the current tunables, into this framework, so that we also have this POC of sorts, which we can use as an example for future tunables that we want to include, which is the next goal that we have in mind, which is to identify tunables that we think would be useful and are not useful enough as constants anymore. Then the next thing that we will do once we have this framework in place with this tunable support is to add the ability to specify global system-wide configuration variables. Something like sysctl.user.conf. We have sysctl.conf where we specify drop interface constants for the kernel, which then get used globally. So we have something like that for MC. When all applications can start with the same set of constants for that, which is same for that distribution. And finally, we want the ability to tweak tunables at runtime, which means you have an application which is running, let's say a long-running web server, and you want to tweak a variable in that running instance. You want to be able to do that. So this is what we did over the last 3 years. So we started in 2013, and we talked about it. And that was probably the most productive year, because there was a lot of difference of opinion in how And 2013, I don't know how many of you were there at the infamous Bob, which lasted something like 3 hours, right? Yeah. So over those 3 years, we managed to at least come together to form this single picture of what the framework should look like and what it should or shouldn't do. 2014, we continued talking about it, and 2015, I made sure we had a spot to talk about it. And it doesn't go in the GNU C Bob. We have enough time for the GNU C Bob. But then there's a little bit more than that we have in 2015. We have a little bit of code, and it's on private branch. It's a prototype code that I wrote in probably a couple of days, some 3 or 4 days. In fact, the reason why I did this talk, or the reason why I submitted this talk, was to get myself to write some code so that I have something to show you. I'm like marginally successful in doing that because I have a prototype, but not actual code that I have learned. Master there. So I have a prototype. I have a prototype framework to register tunables in whatever module, and I also have done a POC for all of the environment variables in malloc. So this is what the framework actually looks like. All of the names in capitals are macros. So the top namespace is something that's defined by default for the entire source as GNU C, because that's the top namespace that we want. But you can always override that on a distribution basis, so that you have a distribution namespace of tunables that you think are relevant for your distribution, but not for GNU C upstream. Then you have a tunable namespace, which is essentially the module within which that tunable is affected and is going to be defined. And then you have these three very simple macros that begin the definition of a tunable, a set of tunables for that module. And then each tunable is registered using the tunable register macro. And then at the end, once you have registered all the tunables for that module, you just call tunable namespace init, and it will initialize all of the tunables at once. So the first take I done for this, I had just have a tunable register. But what I would do is it would iterate across the entire environment variable list for each registration. So which is the reason why I split that into three macros, where you first list down all of the tunables in that module, and then iterate once for all of those. So if you want to take a look at what so here's some sample code. I don't know if you can make this for this one, but I'll try it anyway. So this is what the malloc environment variable in the registration thing looked like. You would take it from the entire set of you would take it from the entire environment variable list, and you would look for specific strings and try to match them to figure out what your environment variable looks like. And what happens after the tunables is just this. You have tunables namespace again, and this is I wish I probably changed this. It says there are 8 macros, and then register those 8 tunables, and in the end, it's just namespace thing. There you go. So all of that RDD code kind of also gets condensed into this coherent piece of routines, and you get a good view of what kind of tunables are defined in this module. Alright, so going back. So the most, the key macro along that implementation is the tunable register macro. What it does is it accepts a tunable name, which is just the short name for the tunable, and alias, which is to maintain backward compatibility with whatever name that we were using earlier, right? And a setter function. So the first iteration for this, what I had done was that I had accepted static variable that you want to change, because that's what it usually is. It's just a static variable that we have a value for whatever name. But then I quickly realized that that's not the only thing that you're required to do when you're setting a tuple. You might have to call some functions to do some kind of initialization, which is the case in malloc, for example. You have to call the lipsy malloc function. In some cases, like malloc check, you need to do some additional work to make sure that additional checking is enabled for malloc. So that void star foo eventually became a setter function which accepts a variable, and it will set whatever value it calls, whatever callback functions that it wants to call. So the second part of the tunables is you have code where you register all the tunables, and then you have a list of tunables that you maintain in this one file called tunables.list, and it has a very specific format where you nest the namespaces to define what namespaces your specific tunables are in. Currently, there's just one top namespace, which is GNU C. On a distribution basis, you might have additional namespaces like say, Google, Ubuntu, or Lenovo, or Red Hat, and so on. So, what's next? You can probably tell I'm hungry. I haven't figured out what the performance cost is, but I'm not very keen on doing that anyway, because this is just a startup performance cost, because most of the tunable initialization happens at startup. And it's not even something that's going to impact on a per-thread basis. So it wouldn't even impact, say, a lot of short-term responding threads. So performance cost is not something that I've been worried about. I need to clean it up and get the master, of course, and port the current environment variables. So I did a quick search yesterday to find out what other environment variables need reported, and as it turns out, there are not a lot of existing environment variables outside of malloc that need reported. There's a few in the resolver which didn't want to have coded, but not much else. I need to implement the system-wide configuration file. Suggestions for the name of the file are open. So cd.0.0 is something that I like, but if anyone has other ideas, we would love to discuss that. Then there's a format of the file. Again, I'm looking at it as the format that's similar to the cd.conf format, so that a system administrator, which is the typical user for this kind of thing, would not have to retrain herself or himself for this thing. And finally, we keep giving them the runway, this is the pipeline. And so I have this fantasy that it should be something like writing, echoing something into the proc interface. But then I discussed this with Roland and others yesterday, and there could be other ways to do it as well. Proc and sys are obviously one option, but then they require calling back into the kernel and so on. You don't want to do that for a user space interval. So there could be other ideas like defining something like system type probe points where you define what location a certain interval is stored in or something like that. It might not work in all cases, but that's one way to probably go about it. Any other ideas, I'm definitely open to that. So that's all I had. I think I've finished with what it's been. I have a lot of time for questions and suggestions.
So I understood from your example, you have a code that sets the values to the macros.
Yes.
Then you have the configuration file.
Yes.
What was the difference of this?
Oh, so the configuration file is, again, is it's not done yet. Tunables.list is the file where we maintain a full list of tunables. The reason why we do this is so that I want to be able to auto-generate the tunable ID list. And what that does is it both files, you won't accidentally export a different kind of a tuple to different name.
So you mean that the GNU C developer writes the tuples on this and then some main file generates the macros?
Yes. So you basically, let's say for example, you have resolver tuples, right? So what you would do is, in tuples.this, you just have libc open bracket, resolve open bracket, HLS conf location or whatever that tuples is, right? And you also have those brackets. And then in resolve code, wherever you are initializing those macros, you just say tuple init, tuple register, sorry, tuple begin, register, and init. That's it. And you have your tuple. So that's I don't know how to do that yet, but that is something that you want to do.
So one thing is, you know, it's tunables for each separate executable might be more useful than tunables per user.
Right. And in fact, that is the reason why tunables for executable is something that you probably get in the meeting. Tunables for the system, for the user, are things that probably happen.
So I can think of examples, multiple examples. Java is a good example of, well, maybe a bad example, I don't know how you open JDK. I don't know if it's a good example or a bad example of like having so many tuple options. You know, as I said, I don't know if that's a good example or if you want to call it a bad example. But I don't think it has runtime configurable tunables.
As in something that you can modify after the process is already set.
And so maybe, you know, maybe that's still a longer term than it should be. Maybe not necessarily ignored, but, you know, I suspect that most people won't be doing that. Unless you have, like, a way to tune tunables automatically. I know that's kind of funky, but I could see a case where, like, a web server, when it's starting to get hit, you want to change the malloc.
I mean, isn't Java's get property, set property from the system high level object just dynamic? Like, you do system set property for a parameter, that parameter is then set forevermore, and then if you if any of the live
code, that's get property in the application. It's not something that you would say signal the Java process.
Okay, yeah.
Which is a different thing. So you had another question?
Well, I had a question. There are 22 environment variables that control the behavior of the dynamic loader. Did you look at applying your three or four macros to those? Were there any cases that fit or didn't fit?
I did not try to pull the dynamic linker variables. In fact, the dynamic linker variables are something that I probably keep aside and not make part of the linker framework.
Why is that?
Because I don't want to. So I want to make sure that the dynamic linker does not depend on anything else when it's started up.
Okay.
So it's got to be as bare bones as possible. So you don't want that mixing in with the rest of the library.
Okay.
But then of course, if
I can understand that.
We can discuss that and we can probably get that done at a later stage.
Yeah, you probably end up having to recompile the code that you have under a different set of object files and linking them in with the loader code. Because otherwise, dependencies that you have that might get executed at startup aren't there.
Yeah.
Right. How early is the MVAR processing from LDSO? It's pretty early. Like, how early is the environment variable processing done for LDSO? And if I remember correctly, it's very early.
It's right at the beginning. It's right at the beginning.
Okay.
And I think they're probably
It's before the PLT is set up, so you're not supposed to be making real function calls.
It's like I said, it's VNP, and that's a price to go for all the variables, and then sets everything very, very early, and then passes on.
So as far as I was concerned, that was the biggest block of environment variables in like all of libc.
It is.
Yeah.
Anyway, any security analysis? Is there any way for this to be exploited?
Security analysis.
Yeah, because
So
I can imagine that somebody can, if he gains some privileged access, he can change it and exploit it or misuse.
Yeah. So security analysis comes into the picture when you're trying to introduce new variables into the terminal framework. That's one place. And the other place is being able to tweak running processes. And we're not there yet for both of those cases. And whenever we're adding new tunables into the framework, I guess we've already agreed that we want to have a fairly
got filled heavy code, it's doing a lot of process creation and children. It's going to be very heavyweight. Have you considered whether you can recompile these so that you can just load a single page?
So it's probably not as heavy as you think it is, because so if you look at the data, the data was actually expanded. There's one page, one initial page, and there's probably one iteration that happens, a couple of iterations that happen to get from that universe page to whatever set of functions into whatever implementation. So that's the only additional overhead that comes in. And you don't have as many tuples right now for that overhead to make any kind of difference. Does that make sense?
I'm not so talked about the indirection as well. There are a lot of times talking more about the passing of a tuples file.
Oh, that happens at compilation. That happens at compilation. And once it's
made, if you have a global tunable, you're passing that file describing all the tunables every time you start the process. That's a lot of text passing.
Oh, the system way. Yes.
So it might be ideal to sort of have a pre-compiled version of that, so that you change it when you run it all. So essentially, it's like a little bit of rebuilding a cache.
Right, that's something.
You remember, Richard, that Siddhesh did say that's live. Like, for next steps are look at the performance cost.
Yeah.
Right? So there's precedent for this in that Solaris has a high level file for controlling process constants, and they did it via an iterator file. And I'm not saying that Solaris is a good example, but they have it there. The other questions that come into account should administrators be able to deny users the ability to change constants in their running processes? Are some things default? Are they not allowed to be changed once they're changed once? Is there a set and make read only? So there's a lot of policy behind what some of this can be. So this is just initial work.
Sure.
I agree with you, reading that file out of etc. is going to be costly, and it's
so
one of the main reasons.
So I think the point now is that this, these are all just sort of the first draft straw man, interface. But also saying that is the interface that sysadmins would use is different from saying that the implementation necessarily works by reading that file,
yeah.
Right? The analog you're making is to the kernel tunables at zsyscuttle.com, and that's a file that just some userland utility reads at boot up and actually applies the tunables by a different mechanism, and how we actually implement this may be something that does not involve each application reading the text file at all.
Yeah.
That's one point. Yeah.
Yeah. One of the things you can do, and which I think would be a part of a final implementation, would be read it at boot up, pre-process it, cache a binary version of it, and then map it into the process.
Yeah.
So and then you map that page in from that file backing, and then all it is pointer directions through that page, just map.
Yep.
So the other way to look at it is that since that file is going to be used by practically all processes in the system, it's always going to be read in page cache. That's one way to look at it. The other way to look at it is you have read ahead in the kernel, which we use to cache that file into memory over there. So your cost has been reduced to just the context switch, which is sort of reading that. But yeah, if you're able to map that in and keep that in memory, that's even better.
Yeah. And the other one, of course, is supporting multiple versions of the library.
Yeah.
On the
same
system. Whether it be different APIs like libraries or even older versions of the library.
So older versions should not be affected by it because
some versions that have it, but if you map it in, you're going to have different formats. That's what he's talking about.
Oh, you mean different formats of the file?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, that's something that you need to look at. Maxim,
I wanted to add to comment that Carl's made about considering that
Most things that we implement in the dynamic linker are also in the static case, are just part of the static C library. And yeah. This would probably be
this
along
is
those lines.
Yeah. I don't remember where I made it, but I think it's named it in the dynamic linker is not on this list. So it's if you're gonna stack your name against it, against the C Rise, so you're gonna get that beautiful score data if you use it.
I'm just wondering if you run into any constants that you can't get the tunables to move, you know, at build time, or maybe something you run into, you think that you shouldn't make that tunable?
No, so I haven't actually done some full research of what kind of variables we want to expose as tunables. I think there was one or two cases that we came across where we wanted to have tunables for them, the default thread stack sizes. And we started working in that direction for those cases, and we realized that other cases might benefit from it too. But we have really looked at all of the constants and looked at the prospect of making them distributed. So that's something that we won't be able to do it individually, that you should be able to have to come to these cases. You know, we want to be able to do this.
So there were some things, right? Tunables that break conformance or break standards conforming behavior are not allowed, right?
Yeah.
Like, that was one of our things. They're like, you shouldn't be allowed to break the application by selecting a tunable. So, because that would have been viewed as a security issue, but non-conforming applications might break anyway if you change things. One of the considered tunables was like group ordering. So NSCD has, when it does group lookups, you might have a benefit of like sorting the groups in a particular order for some reason, and applications might expect the groups to be returned in the order that they're defined in the groups file, but there is some benefit for relaxing that. Really, there's no standard that says it has to be given in the order that they're in the file anyway.
So the general point where we're trying to get, this is gonna be a very incremental process, and where we hope to get to is having a framework where adding or removing or changing individual tuning parameters becomes a very straightforward thing to do, so that from release to release, we may well add tunables, but we might take tunables away. Another thing that Siddhesh didn't mention, but it's something that I harped on when we've discussed this in the past, is that we do not want the set of tunables to become, you know, a permanent API, so that you always, you know, think that forevermore you're going to be able to make this tweak. And so we want to, in our contract with the, you know, users or system administrators, we're going to leave ourselves the freedom to introduce and possibly change and possibly remove particular tuning parameters for what seems to make sense at times.
Yeah,
I'm
just curious about what it does mean that if you put new things that you will file in etc, you want it to support to tunables, you want to put one in there that doesn't isn't
right.
Necessarily supported because you might use the same file across versions,
right.
Which would also mean it very hard to detect typos in that file.
Well, I mean, that's why I think that we're definitely going to have some kind of, you know, tool, some indirection between what that file that an administrator edits by hand and you know, we're not going to have that be just read by every program. We have some kind of utilities, something that, you know, vets your configuration file and also the multiple, you know, whether you want to have a single file that affects all installations of multiple versions, if you have multiple versions on the system, or if you want to have to refer to different files, that all is sort of to be decided.
So Andrew touched on it briefly about having lots of constants. Did you look at how to integrate with TuneD? So for those people that aren't familiar, TuneD is a tuning daemon that runs, that it's an open source tuning daemon that you can run so that at boot up, for example, you can tell it, I want low latency. And so what it does is it goes and sets all the kernel parameters to give you a low latency system. Did you look at integration with 2D yet?
I haven't. So one of the reasons why I came up with the Grok idea was so that I could 2D into something with it.
Yeah.
But then I haven't actually looked at how 2D can interface with it.
Yeah. Okay, yeah, that's right.
What 2D exactly does that we can make it easy for 2D to read or send those parameters.
Yeah. That's true. If you had a Grok interface, 2D is drop in. You basically tell it what the constants are for what groupings and what values.
Okay, any other questions? I think we're done. Oh, almost done.